the chest and abdomen, but that's going down on my probability.
But this cranial exam is far from over. Before she can proceed with the rest of the autopsy, one last suspect must be eliminated. Bacterial meningitis.
Meningitis is an inflammation of meninges, or of the covering of the brain. And babies can get meningitis and go downhill very quickly.
If Anna died from bacterial meningitis, chances are Dr. G will be able to tell by examining the thin membrane covering her brain.
We look to see if that's cloudy or any evidence of infection, and in this case, there isn't. The brain looks completely normal. Alrighty, I'm gonna leave it in your capable hands.
But her many years in the morgue have made her wary of jumping to conclusions.
You never can rule out anything with a baby until you look under the microscope.
But first, she's hoping that the internal exam will provide some more definitive answers. As with an adult, Dr. G begins by performing the standard Y incision.
Immediately when I open the body, I look to see if there's any evidence of trauma, blood collected in any of the body cavities, and I really don't see anything.
There's no free blood in the belly.
I take the chest plate off. I look for any rib fractures. Everything looks fine. There's no evidence of any kind of inflicted injury.
At this point, she is still without a cause of death. But one thing is certain.
We know that trauma didn't contribute to this baby's death. We've cleared the family of any kind of wrongdoing.
Dr. G's next priority is to collect blood samples for forensic analysis.
Before I do anything else, let's see if we can get a little bit of blood here. I'll take blood sterilely.
How are we doing?
And we'll send that off to see if any bacteria is present in the body.
Next, she begins the meticulous process of removing and dissecting Anna's internal organs, one by one, starting with the heart.
When I look at the heart looks normal.
Okay, so her heart looks good.
But as Dr. G digs deeper inside Anna's tiny body, she spots something amiss.
What's interesting is there's no food in the stomach.
You don't want to cut that bowel when you open it.
What that tells me is that this baby hasn't eaten for a while.
It's too early to say whether this finding played any part in Anna's death.
It could just be because this child has been getting over a cold, possibly either been vomiting or diarrhea. So it could be just a red herring.
And incredibly, as Dr. G moves through the remaining organs, they yield little in the way of clues.
She's looking pretty good on the inside.
That is, until she gets to the liver.
That is one big liver, huh?
The liver looks a little large, it looks pale, and it's a little softened.
Funky color.
It looks like a fatty liver, but, you know, the baby shouldn't have fat in the liver.
Something is clearly wrong with baby Anna's liver.
The liver's not looking good, I can tell.
But the question is, did it play a role in her death?
Even though I can't say specifically what's wrong with the liver, I'm hoping that will hold the key to the answer to this case.
Okay, let's see.
I have to take micros of it. I'll definitely need to look at that under the microscope.
I'll just grab a bunch of those loose.
Dr. G takes tissue samples of the infant's liver, as well as her other major organs. These will be mounted onto slides for microscopic examination. The autopsy of baby Anna Gaetan has now come to an end. Unfortunately, her death certificate still remains blank.
If the answer comes simply, I will be pleased, but I doubt very well.
The microscopic slides, along with the blood cultures, are now Dr. G's last chance of uncovering the truth behind Anna's tragic death.
I always worry whenever I do an autopsy that I'm not going to have an answer. That just comes with the nature of the job. And sometimes I don't have an answer.
took a lot longer than I wanted it to.
It's been 2 weeks since the autopsy of six-month-old Anna Gaetan. And as Dr. G waits for her cultures and microscopic slides to come back from the lab, she worries that this could be one of those cases that never gets closed.
It's going to be difficult to figure this out if it's not clear-cut.
As for Anna's parents, it's an agonizing limbo.
You know, once a baby dies, there's tremendous consequences for them. Do they want to have another baby? Why did this baby die? Are we going to chance that again? Maybe it's something wrong with us. They want an answer.
But when Anna's tox report is finally delivered to the lab, it unfortunately reveals nothing.
My cultures were negative. Now, I'm really worried my last hope is going to be in the micros.
Four days later, she receives the long-awaited slides.
The heart, the lungs, in the brain, all of those organs look normal.
This leaves only one place left to look for an explanation.
The liver, I'm hoping, is what's going to give us that answer.
Under the powerful lens of the microscope, the liver cells come into view.
I can see that it's abnormal. What it showed was a very fatty liver, much more fatty than I expected by just looking at the liver. Once I see that there's fat in the liver, putting it all together with what I knew about the way it died, the fact that there's no food in its stomach, that sets in motion in my mind a whole other cause of death.
Dr. Jean now believes she knows what killed baby Anna, but speculation is not enough. She will need to order a special and unusual test to support her theory. At the time, only a couple of research labs in the country were conducting this test. But Dr. G finds one at the University of Texas in Dallas.
And so I went ahead and sent a piece of liver, urine, and blood off to the lab, hoping that they'll confirm my hunch. And as soon as I got the results back from the lab, I knew I had my answer.
Dr. G is now able to reconstruct the simple tragedy of baby Anna Gaetan's short life. For the first 6 months of her life, baby Anna's tiny body functions normally.
This child doesn't have any problems until it gets a viral infection.
For most infants, a cold is harmless. But in baby Anna's case, it sets into motion a fatal chain reaction.
It stresses its body, and it also makes it not want to eat.
With no food coming in, Anna's body finds itself quickly running out of fuel. At this point, a normal baby would simply tap into its reserves of stored body fat to get the energy it needs to survive. But with baby Anna, there's an unexpected problem.
This is probably one of the first times in its life that it's really trying to break down a fat because it was being fed well. But once it got that viral infection and it wasn't eating, and then all of a sudden, hey, I need some fuel here. Let's break down some fats. Well, then it comes to light. There's something wrong with the baby.
The lab results confirm that baby Anna was born with an extremely rare genetic disorder called a fatty acid oxidation defect.
What that means is that this poor kid can't break down fat.
Because her body can't break down the fat, it starts accumulating in her organs, mostly in the liver, which explains its fatty appearance. And that's not all.
Because it couldn't utilize the fat for fuel, its blood sugar plummeted. The combination of these two things are causing the baby to become lethargic and causing its muscles not to be as strong as they normally are.
When Anna's father, Armando, comes in to change her diaper, she barely has the strength to raise her head. That's when he and his wife, Sophia, decide to rush their baby to the hospital. But by then, it's too late.
think the baby's in pain. It's dying from lack of fuel, and its brain's not going to function anymore. And that, coupled with probably an arrhythmia, causes the baby to die suddenly.
A sad and abrupt end to a life cruelly cut short.
This is Dr. Garvalia at the medical examiner's office.
All that remains is for Dr. G to report her findings to Anna's parents.
The family was shocked because the baby acted normal to this point. How could it have such a thing?
But fortunately, in recent years, there have been tremendous advances in newborn screening tests for this rare condition.
Medicine has progressed since I did this case, and the technology has gotten better. Now, it would be no problem getting this tested. In 20 years, this is my only fatty acid deficiency. They're very rare, but you still have to keep the rare in the back of your mind. Because if you don't think about it, you're not going to find it.
Dr. G uses every tool.